Good morning, Rockridge Church. Thank you so much for joining us on another beautiful Sunday morning. It's always a blessing when we can come together around the open Word of God and study it as a family. Allow me to make just two quick invitations before we get into our study of the Word. If you would, go ahead and turn your calendars to the month of September. The first event that I want to tell you about and invite you to is our next Rockridge Blood Drive. That will take place on Sunday, September 18th, out here at the property. Our friends over at Lifestream Blood Bank will be bringing their big Bloodmobile bus out here to the property, and they'll be accepting donations from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m., and as usual, we'll be serving a nice little lunch out here at Rockridge. So if you'd like to come and donate blood, have a sandwich, and be with your brothers and sisters, feel free to join us again on Sunday, September 18th, anytime between 9 a.m. and 1 p.m. Also in September, our women's ministry is running their annual retreat. This year it will go from September 9th until September 11th. And I'll just say for more details and information about that, feel free to check out our official social media channels, the Rockridge Church Facebook page or Instagram page, or even find more details on our website at rockridgechurch.org. Now, let's turn our attention to the Word. We are continuing on in our study of 1 Peter, and this morning we arrive at the first verse of 1 Peter chapter 4. And if you look at how that verse begins, you'll probably notice that it starts off very much the same way as our study last week. Peter taking us back to Jesus' suffering on the cross. Remember, the image, the last thing that Peter showed us at the conclusion of 1 Peter chapter 3, that was at verse 22, was Jesus in that place of highest honor and greatest authority, sitting at the right hand of the Father, with all the angels, all authorities, and all powers being subjected to him. And now, here at 1 Peter 4:1, the apostle instead takes us back to the cross, as if to show us the link between Jesus at the right hand of the Father and Jesus on the cross, to remind us that it is only through suffering his humiliation and death by crucifixion that Jesus arrives on that heavenly throne, that it was only after he died and was resurrected that Jesus gathered his disciples together and told them, "All authority on earth and in heaven has been given to me." That image of Jesus on the throne has been for us throughout this letter a source of great encouragement that Peter's been giving to his readers over and over. That we can continue and press on in doing good and obeying God, even if that means we have to suffer for it, knowing all along that our Savior is on the throne, that he is in charge. It's a word that tells Christians that we never need to be anxious to make our own version of justice or to avenge our own suffering. Vindication and vengeance belong to the Lord. And he sits on the throne already, and nothing escapes his sight. And for elect exiles like us and like Peter's original audience, I don't know what better word there could be than that. But Peter today takes us back to the cross to begin our study. The cross of Jesus Christ sits at the center of all Christian behavior. The cross is where the atoning sacrifice for our sins was made. It is where the justifying blood that gives us relationship with God was spilled. It is the way, it is the means for our regeneration, that is our new birth into new life. It's what makes our resurrection possible. What gives us hope for eternal life is that our Lord died and rose from death. It is the cross where we who were dead in our trespasses can finally be made alive by the grace and mercy of God. And now, what we have here in 1 Peter 4:1 is the apostle telling us that in addition to being all those things, the cross also stands for us as the ultimate example for God's people to follow. Jesus who does all things perfectly, he even suffered perfectly. And the story of his passion and his crucifixion gives us an ideal to aspire to in our own lives, in our own suffering, in the way we deal with evil. So those who have ears to hear this morning as we prepare to read the word, let them hear. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you for giving us this time today to come together around your word. God, give us wisdom and vision to understand it. Lord, make the book live to us. Make the word alive to us. Let it correct us. Let it reform us however we need today. Lord, give us the humility to hear and receive what your word has for us this morning. In your glorious name, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Since, therefore, Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. Peter says, remember that Jesus also suffered. As you suffer, remember your Lord suffered. Now, he has said that before. He's given us that point earlier in this letter, but it is somewhat different what he's saying this time. Because this time, Peter's not just saying, remember that Jesus suffered in his body. This time, Peter is saying, consider also the mind of Christ about his suffering. Consider and remember how Jesus thought about the cross, how he perceived his suffering on the cross, and how he explained the cross that he was about to bear to his disciples. Now, it's fair to ask how we can know what Jesus thought about the cross, but as Paul would remind us, we have the mind of Christ. It is revealed to us in the scriptures what Jesus thought about his suffering. We can know from the scriptures that Jesus knew it was his mission to come here and die as the once-for-all atoning sacrifice for sin. That Jesus knew he came to take away the sins of the world by submitting to be killed as the spotless Lamb of God. Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, is very telling about this because this happens immediately after Peter confesses Jesus as Messiah for the first time. And then Jesus teaches him how his messianic mission is to be fulfilled. So it's like, okay, you finally have had it revealed to you who I am. Now here is how I will do what I'm supposed to do, what I've been sent here to do. As Mark chapter 8, verse 31 records it for us, this is when Jesus said to his disciples, Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. And after 3 days, rise again. Now there's one small word in there that's carrying a lot of weight in that sentence. And that word is must. It is loaded with meaning there. Because Jesus didn't just say that his suffering would happen or that he expected it to happen. This wasn't just like a rationalization based on how he had gotten along with the Pharisees and the scribes. He said it must happen. Why must anything happen? Well, the only things that must happen are the things that fulfill the divine will of God. So Jesus must suffer because the will of the Father would only be satisfied through his sacrifice on the cross. His plan for our salvation, to give eternal life to his elect people, would only be satisfied through Jesus' suffering in the flesh. So it must happen. And as we know, it was none other than Peter himself who rose up out of that group of disciples and tried to dispute Jesus on that point. It was Peter who had to be rebuked as Satan and told by Jesus, you are not setting your minds on the things of God, but of man. Jesus knew, understood, and chose his suffering. He submitted to it. He embraced it. He had it within his power to get out of it. As Mark chapter 26, verse 53 has it, he told Peter in the garden as he was being arrested that he could call down 12 legions of angels to come and fight on his behalf, to beat back the Roman guards, to chase Judas Iscariot away and deliver him to safety. But the scriptures must be fulfilled, and there is no other way. His suffering must be so. Jesus considered it better in every sense that he should endure this pain, that he should endure this terrible death. Because that was the Father's will. The cup could not be passed from him. He learned that praying in the garden, that there could be no other way. Jesus' response to that, well, we find it in Matthew 26, 39. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. You'll notice if you go through the Gospels that when Jesus is in chains and is being presented to the council and he's being presented to Pilate, he does not utter a word in his own defense. He doesn't skirt the questions of the high priest. He doesn't lie about who he is to get out of the punishment that's to come. Even when Pilate says, you know, I have the power to release you, Jesus does not beg for mercy. He tells the truth about where Pilate's authority comes from. He had already embraced his cross, submitted to the Father's will, and was ready to accept all the pain that came with it. That, Peter says, that is the way of thinking that Jesus had about his suffering. And that's the way of thinking that we are to arm ourselves with. To make doing the will of our Father ultimate good to be worked for, the object of all of our obedience and all of our effort. If Jesus embraced his cross, if he accepted that he must suffer in the flesh to do the will of God, well, Peter is saying we should prepare ourselves by thinking the same way. It is our Father's will that we would, as Peter puts it so many times throughout this letter, do good. And if we must suffer at the hands of our human contemporaries for going out and doing good as God has told us to do, well, Peter's telling us we need to have the mind of Christ about this. We need to arm ourselves with it. Our Father's will must be done. If it is God's will that we would silence our enemies, not through combat, but by answering their evil with blessing. If it is God's will that we would shut up their slander by continuing to do good as they do evil to us, well, then we should count it better that we would suffer in our service to our Father. We would count that better than any attempt to escape the suffering that's coming to find us, or to avenge ourselves of the evil done against us. The mind we should have from Christ might be summed up in one line of this letter that Peter wrote back at chapter 3, verse 17. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. Now, this might be a hard word to accept, but that might be precisely why we need it and why we have it. It is a word that needs to be heard and taken to heart, because our flesh will not want to live this way. Our flesh will want vengeance of its own kind. Our flesh will want to meet evil with an equal or even greater amount of evil. Our fallen nature doesn't want to embrace or endure suffering in any form, for any reason. And we will be tempted from within and from without to escape difficulty, to flee from suffering, to find some way around it or out from under it at all costs. We will be tempted to lie. We will be tempted to cheat. We will be tempted to steal or even to blaspheme against the name and gospel of our Lord Jesus Messiah, if only that means we might suffer a little bit less. That was certainly true for Peter's audience, and it may be true for us in varying degrees. There aren't Roman guards looking for us to persecute us, to arrest us, to tie us up on stakes and light us on fire like there were for Peter's audience. But persecution comes in many forms and many different degrees of severity. So this is still a word we need to accept and be formed by. We still need to follow Peter's instructions and prepare our minds, ready ourselves, arm ourselves with this mind of Christ so that we can, to once again borrow Paul's words from 2 Timothy chapter 2, as good soldiers of Christ, we can share in the sufferings of our Lord Jesus. And as we continue on in verse 1 of 1 Peter 4, the apostle writes, "Arm yourselves with the same way of thinking, for whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin." It's kind of a strange sounding phrase there, isn't there? What could Peter mean when he says that Christians who suffer in the flesh cease from sin? Well, there is one thing we can know just on the witness of other parts of the scriptures. Peter isn't telling us that just because a Christian suffers physically, they're somehow now incapable of sinning. There's two New Testament verses that will always be true about our lives that we live out in this world. One of them is James 3:2, that we all stumble in many ways. And the other one is 1 John 1:8, that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. It's true that Benjamin Franklin wrote that the only things for certain in our lives here are death and taxes, but he didn't have it quite right. I'd say there's two more things that are for certain: human sin and the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ to save us from it. So what Peter is saying here cannot be that the Christian who endures suffering will therefore never sin again. But he is saying something. He's saying that if a Christian overcomes the temptation that suffering brings, that if a Christian can resist all the urges to escape from their suffering that will come to them from the world, from their own flesh, and even from the devil, that's not nothing. That means something. That shows us something. That shows us that they have decided in a definitive and meaningful way that they are done living solely to please their flesh. They are done living solely for pleasure and only for sin. That they are now choosing to devote their lives to the will of God. That by His grace and His mercy, they have made a break from an old life where all they knew and all they wanted were sinful, empty things of the world. That God has given them grace to want more than what C.S. Lewis would have called the mud pies made in a slum. That's what our sin is. Those who endure have finally learned to want, instead of the mud pies, the Lord's offer of a holiday at sea. That instead of the empty gratification of the flesh, they have chosen the infinite joy offered to us in the gospel of our crucified and risen Messiah. The desire to avoid pain, to avoid it at all costs, it's very real. We want comfort. We want peace. But the joy of serving and obeying the Lord, that's real too. You need to know that it is greater than anything else that we can experience in this world. To know that we have received the grace of God to choose or behave or live our lives in a way that He calls us to. Our flesh will always want us to believe that it would be better for us to walk unencumbered. But we know, by God's grace we know, that it is always better to accept the invitations of our Lord Jesus, to take up our cross, bear its weight, and follow Him. To do and obey the will of our God, no matter what the cost. So let us cling to the reminder of our Lord Jesus, which we receive from Matthew 16:16, that gaining even the whole world profits us nothing if it means we have to trade away our soul to get it. I was talking with someone about these messages that we have been doing from 1 Peter lately, and he said something like, well, Peter says I'm supposed to suffer, right? Now, he was halfway kidding, and I know he was halfway kidding. But there might be something real there. And there might be others of you wondering the same kind of thing. Is Peter saying that Christians are supposed to suffer? Is Peter saying that the Christian life is just suffering all the time? Well, let me offer this as an answer and a correction. We need to make an important distinction. Peter is not saying in this letter that it is your duty or your prescribed life as a Christian to just suffer, that you will only know suffering. And he certainly has not said that you should go and suffer just for the sake of suffering. He writes a lot about suffering, yes, but nowhere in this letter does he say that God's people are simply just supposed to suffer because it's good for them or because it's what God wants for them. He doesn't say go and suffer. Peter says, what we're supposed to do, what we're called to do, is to be holy. And I don't want us to lose sight of that, because it's very important to our understanding of this letter. It is not the suffering that Peter has called us to. It is to be holy. To be holy as the one who called us is holy, as he wrote in 1:15. To conduct ourselves with the fear of God throughout our lives as exiles in this world, because we know we were ransomed with the most precious blood of Jesus Christ, as he wrote in 1:19. To live, as he puts it now, here at verse 2 of chapter 4, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. Our calling is to live out the regenerated life that God has given us. To live out the beautiful life among the Gentiles. And to live it so fully that it bears witness to the power of the gospel as we live among them. We are called by Peter to live holy lives, not just to suffer. But he is being very intentional about telling us that if the cost of living these lives, these lives that God has chosen us to live, these holy lives, if the cost of living that way is that suffering would be visited upon us, well, Peter wants you to know that that is a cost that is worth paying. And he's trying to prepare us as his readers to be willing to pay that price. So no, we were not chosen by God for a life that is only suffering. We were chosen by God for a life that is holiness. And we are given the mercy of God and the glorious salvation that comes to us through Jesus Christ so that we actually can live the kinds of lives that we were chosen for. So you don't have to go looking for opportunities to suffer. You are always to be looking for opportunities to do good, however. You should always be looking for opportunities to bless. The reality that Peter illustrates for us in this letter is that if you focus on that, well, you don't have to go looking for suffering. If you live this beautiful life and you live it fully enough, well, then the opposition and the suffering will come and find you. And all the hardships will be brought straight to you. You don't have to go out and get them. God has called you to give your life fully to this pursuit of gospel-centered, grace-powered holiness. To stop living for human passions, that's what the Gentiles do, and instead to live for the will of God. That's what Peter said in verse 2. Now listen to what the apostle writes at verse 3. For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you. Live for the will of God. Live the holy life he has called you to. Peter says, because the time that you have already spent living for your sins and gratifying your flesh with all the basest desires of your sinful heart, however long you spent living that way, it was enough. And the time to live that way is past. So whether you spent 5 or 10 or 60 years living without the gospel, living apart from the grace of God, that time is finished. However long or however short you spent living dead in your trespasses, you are now to count that time as over and done, because you have been made alive in Christ by the mercy of God. So whoever you were, whatever you were like, before you were given the grace from God to believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, we are to count that person as gone, as dead now. That's the kind of language Paul used back in Galatians in chapter 2 and verse 20, that he considered his old self to be crucified with Christ, put to a brutal and total death. He says, I'm still here, but it's not really me anymore. I'm alive, but it's no longer I who live. It is Christ who lives in me. Now, we should not be overly callous to this long list of sins that Peter writes there and that he calls the flood of debauchery. We should not read them and roll our eyes and say, oh, what kind of foolishness is this? Because we must remember, we must be humble enough to remember that at one time, things like these were all that we wanted in the world. These were the kinds of things that when we were just living in the flesh, when we were dead, we aspired to have these kinds of things. We wanted to be at the parties. We wanted to go and have all the pleasures. We wanted to escape from reality in drunkenness. We wanted all these things. It's all we worked for. It's what we thought the height of joy and pleasure and fulfillment would be. So we have an opportunity when we read this list of sins to just stop and praise and glorify God. Thank God for the gospel of Jesus Christ and praise God that out of the richness of his mercy, even when we were dead in our trespasses, living like this, he made us alive together with Christ. We were so far off here, but he brought us near. He paid the price to bring us near, because we know we're only brought near to God by the blood of our Savior Jesus. We get to call ourselves his workmanship now, reborn and regenerated to do his will, to do the good works that he's prepared for us. If the good news has an opening paragraph, that's it. Largely developed from Ephesians 2, by the way. So Peter says we have had enough time to live this old life, to be the old self. Now we're not to make any provision for it anymore. Crucify it, put it to death, and put it away. We were once dead in trespasses. The call to holiness means we're now to be dead to sin. It is time, as Paul says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 9, to put off the old self with all of its old practices and put on the new. Peter's message throughout much of this letter has been to just stop doing evil and instead to do good. That's in really short, simple form, living the holy and beautiful life to which we're called. And he has told us throughout this letter that mode of life, that life that seeks and accepts the will of God, that does what God's will is and not what Gentiles want to do, that kind of life bears witness. It is a powerful thing to do that in the sight of others. That life is by itself a testimony to the saving and transforming, very real power of the gospel, of our regeneration, our new birth. It is the expression of all that God has done in us to make us new. But Peter gives us a warning here in verse 4. It's a testimony. Our holiness is a testimony, but it's not a testimony that will always be well received. It's not a testimony that will always even be accepted or understood. People will notice that your life seems to be different now. They'll notice that you've stopped living like you used to. And some will be puzzled by it. That's actually the more literal translation of what we have in the Greek there, instead of just surprised, that they'll be confused and puzzled by it. That even if they were to come to you and ask you about this hope you have, and you tell them, well, it's all because of the gospel, well, we know that many will count that as a load of foolishness. That they'll say it really must be either insanity or sudden onset stupidity, because now you don't show up to these things that it seems like you used to like. We don't see you at the pub or the bar anymore. We don't see you at dance night or karaoke night at the clubs anymore. It doesn't seem like you're trying to take anyone with a pulse and a working heart and a halfway working brain to bed with you anymore. You don't live like us anymore. And because they don't really get it, they'll reject the testimony of your holy life, and instead they'll insult you. They'll heap abuse on you, as Peter says. So you might have to have some hateful words thrown at you. Like, oh, do you think you're so much better than us now? Oh, why don't you just come off your high horse? Oh, you Christians, all self-righteous all the time, like you have it all figured out. Hey, why don't you stop being so holier than thou, you buzzkill? Don't be such a Bible thumper. Jesus warned his disciples to be prepared to live and serve, really as exiles in the world, to be prepared to live and serve in a world that hates them, not because they're bad people, but because they belong to him. They identify with him. They define their life by him. So elect exiles in our own day should be nothing less. Be prepared for nothing less. Our holy living invites the hatred of an unregenerate world that feels somehow judged because we don't participate in the sins and the idolatry that they do. What we call bearing good fruit, they'll call poisonous. As Jesus said in John 15, at verse 18, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you're not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. I'd like us actually to remember a word also from really what I think is one of the great quotes of all time, written by a guy named Anthony the Great, one of our brothers in Christ from all the way back in the 3rd century AD. He wrote this: a time is coming when men will go mad, and when they see someone who is not mad, they will attack him, saying, you are not mad, you are not like us. That's the kind of life that we might have to have as we pursue the holiness that God calls us to. Rejection will be a part of it, mostly from people who don't understand it and from people who feel judged by it. But Peter is eager not to let his readers get discouraged by that reality, by what he wrote there in verse 4. If suffering is a theme of 1 Peter, and it definitely is, well, then so is the sovereignty and the love and the promises of God. For every word that Peter gives us, that he instructs us to endure suffering, he's also backed it up with a word of encouragement that we can draw strength from the knowledge of where Christ is now, that he is at the right hand of the Father, that he is sovereign, that he is in control. The greatest source of encouragement for us as God's people is just knowing about the rule and the reign of Jesus Christ. So yeah, we will be insulted and we will be hated just because we identify with the Lord. But our Lord is at our Father's right hand. And we know that all powers and authorities are subject to him. We get to know that his eyes are upon us and nothing escapes his sight. And that he will eventually hold all things in judgment. Peter's saying that again here at verse 5. Yeah, people will malign you, but they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. Jesus has the ultimate authority to judge every human life, not just in our generation, but every human life that has ever been lived from the beginning of creation to today. All who have ever lived, all who have ever passed away will stand for judgment before the throne of God. As John says in Revelation chapter 20, he sees the dead, great and small, at the final judgment. That they have been taken out of the grave to be judged by the Lord. And on that day, whenever God chooses to bring it to us, when we have to go and stand before the throne, praise God, what will matter is how we responded to our Savior on the cross. Praise God, we get to know that the elect are saved because God has given us the grace to know and believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ crucified and to trust totally in his saving power and his promises of our eternal inheritance. The gospel is the power of our salvation. As Peter says in verse 6, it is because of the saving power of the gospel that it was preached to previous generations, or as he puts it, even to those who are dead. There does seem to be in the early church that they were wrestling with this question of, well, what has become of brothers and sisters who we knew who passed away? You see Paul addressing it also in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and to a lesser extent in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Well, the answer is somewhat simple, and Peter has just summarized it for us in this word. The gospel gives life, and there will be this resurrection. All will stand for judgment from every generation, and those who are saved will be saved by the power of the good news. It doesn't matter if their bodies have died in our generation, in our time, or as he puts it, if they have been judged in the flesh like other men, that's what that means. Everyone gets to have eternal life in the spiritual realm if they belong to God, if they believe in his gospel. All the elect get to live forever in paradise, like God does. We began this section at 1 Peter 4:1, and in that verse, Peter pointed us once more to the cross, to the suffering of Jesus. We conclude here at verse 6 with Peter telling us that the good news of Jesus Christ has the power to give life to all who believe in it. By his death and resurrection, we get to be reborn. We get to be resurrected and glorified. In our time here, we get to live the holy, regenerated, born again lives that God has called us to. And in eternity, we get to enjoy life in paradise in fellowship with God according to his promises. That is our unfading inheritance. We will stand for the final, ultimate judgment of God. If it happens in our lifetimes, we will be counted as the living. If we pass on and it happens sometime later, we will be resurrected from the dead for it. We and every generation of people who've lived before us and every generation that might come after us, and by the mercy of God, when the elect go before his great white throne and those books are opened, it will not be our own merits that we will be judged on. It will be on his promises. Everything that the good news says about what he has done and what it means for us who believe in him. And that is an everlasting spring of strength for us to draw from. So, let the world slander us. They hated Jesus. It's only natural they would hate us who identify with Jesus. Let the world go on doing what pagans do while we submit to what God wants, to what he wills. And when the world intersects with us and heaps abuse on us for doing good, well, let us put them to shame and to silence by living out our calling and blessing them, doing good for them, clinging to a living hope in the middle of suffering, however bad, when it comes to find us. Let us be found always saying that it is better to serve the Lord, no matter the cost, than to serve ourselves. Well, thank you so much for your time and attention. It's kind of merciful that we have reached the end here, because, man, you have no idea how hot it is in this little building right now. I have been sweating this whole time. You've probably noticed, so thanks for bearing with me. Let's pray, and then I'll hand it off to Chris, and we will worship together. In your glorious name, Lord Jesus, we thank you for the word today. God, help us to conform ourselves to that way of thinking about our suffering that you had about the cross. Lord, let us always be pleased to do your will, to count that as things that must be done, as things that we should not try to escape from, that we should not be tempted to run away from. Lord, if the price that we must pay for living holy lives and doing good is to endure evil, well then, God, give us grace to count that as better, to know and agree that it is better to do good and suffer for it than to do evil. Lord, help us to live these beautiful lives that you've called us to. Give us the grace and the power and the wisdom be the kinds of people that your people should be. In your glorious name, dear Jesus, we beg for your help today. Amen. Thank you again for your time and attention. Please remember us in your regular giving. All right, I'm going to hand it off to Chris now. Let's worship our God together.
Stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heaven and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice, come and lift your head and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice, sing of mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. We are children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood, bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let them go. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice, sing of mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. All our sickness, all our sorrows, Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still. Turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice, when you cry to him, he hears your voice. He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice, in the midst of suffering, he will help you sing. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice, sing of mercies of your King, and with trembling